for coming out. I hope you guys are enjoying the day of action in general. We're so happy that you chose our teaching. So we are three members of the Princeton Refugee Project. Sorry, I stole your chair. Anyway, yeah, so my name is Ben. I'm a second year master's student in mechanical engineering. And this is Julie Whittaker. She's a second year MPA in the Woodrow Wilson School. This is Chiara. You are a
second year
undergraduate. Do you have
anthropology major.
In anthropology. And so we are, each of us have different reasons for why we're here today. And you'll hear a little bit of our stories as just students who have found ourselves getting involved with the refugee issue. For those of you who are also considering getting involved or have maybe been involved already, we'd love to hear some of your stories. So a little bit, just kind of a roadmap of where we're going today. Each of us will, but so I'll give a brief introduction, and then we'll hear from a professor who is working with an organization called Every Campus a Refuge, which is seeking to, well, I won't steal her thunder. And then we'll hear a little bit about some specific, Princeton-specific activism that's happening with regards to the refugee issue, both on the undergraduate side and the graduate side. And then we'll open it up basically for, well, I should say that as part of our project here at Princeton, we sponsor a refugee student named Noir, and we'll actually have a chance to hear from her. She's in university in Jordan, and so we'll get a chance to hear a video of her, an interview that we conducted with her, so we get to know her a little bit. So barring any technical difficulties, we will be able to see all this. Thanks so much for being here. So I guess for me personally, before I came to Princeton, I basically had been in Turkey for 3.5 years doing a master's degree, and I was there from 2011 to 2014, which meant that, as those of you who may be familiar with the refugee issue know, that this was basically the time, the first 3 years of the Syrian civil war. And so halfway through my time in Turkey, you really started to see refugees, people just piling up on the streets, like literally sleeping on cardboard boxes, camping out under underpasses, this was just like, it was in your face. You couldn't escape it. People begging on the street, and the cars are stopped at a red light. Little children coming up to you, they don't speak Turkish or English, they just speak Arabic, so they hold a sign that says, I'm Syrian, give me money, basically. there weren't too many organized things happening in our city, unfortunately, at that point. Now there's many things, but it just started with me and a couple of my Muslim friends, like a combination of Muslim and Christian friends, collecting money, buying coats, and driving around trying to find Syrians and give them coats. Since coming to Princeton, I've sought to continue to be involved in this. I found these guys working in the Princeton Refugee Project. When I finished my degree, I hope to return and be able to contribute somehow to this crisis. The crazy thing about the moment that we're in right now is that at the very moment that the United States is seeking to close its doors to refugees, we have the largest refugee crisis since World War II. This is a critical moment for us as a country to decide what kind of an identity we want to have. And regardless of our politics or our faith, this is an issue that I think we can all get behind. So I'm really psyched to see some of you guys here. With that, I will hand it over and we'll move on.
I don't think I project as well as Ben, so I'm going to use the microphone if you allow me. Again, my name is Julie Whittaker. I'm a second year master's in public affairs candidate at the Woodrow Wilson School. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my background and what I've been involved in at Princeton, hoping that this sparks conversations, discussion, perhaps other people getting involved in similar activities. And we're happy to talk about that more in the discussion as well. In regards to my background, I spent 3 years prior to joining the Woodrow Wilson School living in Jordan. I worked on the Syrian refugee response in Za'atari refugee camp, which is the second largest refugee camp in the world. It's located in the north of Jordan. Around 80,000 people live there. It's a tiny fraction of the Syrian refugee population in Jordan, which is over 650,000 registered, perhaps over a million if you count unregistered refugees in Jordan. So that's really what brought me to the forefront of this issue, particularly in regards to the Syrian crisis. But of course, as Ben was saying, we know that this has this is an issue that's affected many countries, different nationalities. Jordan had a Somali and Sudanese refugee population, which I think is important to remember in light of the edited travel ban, which also includes those countries. And these are all people who are facing great persecution and have fled and sought safety in a host country where they're still unable to fulfill their basic needs and reach their basic human dignity. Coming back to Princeton was a tough transition. You can imagine from working in a refugee camp where the common denominator is a lack, either a lack of access, a lack of services, unmet needs. And coming back to Princeton, which is really in the excess of luxury, right? The blessing we have to be here as students, as faculty, community members, is really a great gift. So I started dialoguing with students at other graduate institutions about what students could do. How could we make our small impact in alleviating this suffering? And we landed on our calling, we felt, to help other students. So to that end, we looked at what university students were doing when they became refugees. What happened to the 20-year-old nursing major in Syria when he was forced to flee his home? What does he do with an interrupted education? How does he chart a future that seems so bleak? What opportunities does he have? And more we realized, and agencies across the spectrum with the UN and other international NGOs have realized, that this youth group, let us say 18 to 30-year-olds, are really facing a unique crisis as well. Unable to plan for a future, unable to build their skills, feeling like they're wasting their time, unable to look towards rebuilding their country someday when they don't have the education or the skills to realize that goal. So we decided that we would want to support students to continue their higher education and began fundraising to support scholarships. That's part of what brought Chiara, Ben, and I all together. We formed a group at the graduate level. It's called the Princeton Refugee Project. At the undergraduate level, it's called the Princeton Clay Project. And we began doing fundraising events, trying to gather the funds needed to support a scholarship for a Syrian refugee who was living in a refugee camp in Jordan to attend a local university. We successfully raised half the funds and partnered with another university, Wesleyan University in Connecticut, to provide a scholarship to a student named Noir, who lives in Za'atari refugee camp and has been there since the early days of the crisis. She's currently there, she's studying English literature, plans to go on into law and international relations, and we'll hear from her at the end of our conversation today. The last thing I'll note, perhaps just to spark ideas, is about the different things the Princeton Refugee Project has done on campus and continues to do. Again, we have a focus on helping students. That's taking the form of fundraising and supporting these higher education initiatives. We've also been dedicated to raising awareness, planning events like the Refugee Walk, which Chiara spearheaded with the Nassau Presbyterian Church to raise awareness about the distances people are traveling, the dangerous paths people are taking, be it to Turkey or onward to Europe. We're planning a film screening. Those who have not seen The White Helmets, it's heartbreakingly true, but we hope to bring it to campus and show it here. And we're also working on political advocacy, whether it's around letting our representatives know where we stand in regards to opening our doors to refugees of all nationalities, Syrians included, and also to remind our politicians that we care about ending these wars, the wars that caused people to flee in the first place, which is often something that's left out of the conversation as too complicated or too difficult or maybe not our problem. But we feel very strongly that all aspects of what forces a person to flee are our problem, something we want to respond to. So with that, perhaps I'll give it to Chiara to talk a little bit about her involvement and also introduce our speaker.
thank you. I'm Chiara, and I'm an undergraduate. And so my biggest issue was how could we bring the Syrian refugee crisis on campus and how we could make fundraising something that felt less removed to the Princeton student body. And so me and another group of two girls, who unfortunately can't be here today, we started thinking about ways in which the student body could physically and tangibly feel connected to the money that they're donating. And so this is what we do. We make mugs and vases made by Princeton students, and then we sell them, and all these funds that are raised go towards the ML scholarship, which supports Noir's education. And then towards the middle of last semester, we started thinking about ways in which we as Princeton students could support refugee families here on the Princeton campus through Every Campus a Refuge, which is a movement that was started at Guilford College, in which universities as a campus actually resettle families on campus. And this is an initiative that we are trying to bring to the Princeton University campus. Right now, we are collecting signatures amongst the student body, because before we can present this to the administration, we really need to show that this is something that the university students want. It's not something that just the faculty want who have expressed interest. And of course, this is not an easy thing to resettle a family on campus. And so with that, Dia Abjo, who is the founder of Every Campus a Refuge at Guilford College, is just gonna speak about her experience of how Guilford came to resettle families on campus and how that process could look like if it were to be implemented at Princeton.
Dia, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me? I have turned off my mic so that you can hear me doing other things. Okay.
Oh, great.
Can you hear me now?
Go for it.
Go for it.
Awesome. Wonderful. So can you see me, or I'm not sure how this is working.
We would love to see you.
I am sure, but I don't know how to do that. I can see myself.
Right.
I saw up on the screen, but can't see you.
I don't see
you. Okay, well, for time, we can hear you perfectly, so.
Wonderful. And you all know that today on Friday, I'm going to give you the full rundown of what I'm going to talk about today. And so, Chiara, I have, 10 minutes?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. So Every Campus a Refuge is an initiative that came out of several factors. I was inspired by the group's call, Pope Francis, who called on every parish in Europe to host a refugee family, and that was back in 2015. And I don't know if you know, but the Arabic word for campus is haram, which literally means refuge. And so I thought it makes perfect sense of college campus and university campus has all this, the resources, the facilities, the buildings, the human skills and resources needed to take in a refugee family and assist them in resettlement in the institution's local area. What you need to remember is, to be able to do this, you need to partner with a local refugee resettlement agency in your area, and they will assign you one of their cases that comes in. And I want to say, I know Chiara, you said it's not easy. Actually, it's very easy to do this. So far, we have resettled 4 cases. We're currently hosting an 11-member family, and we begin hosting a 5-member family on Wednesday concurrently. So the way that Every Campus a Refuge works is that
you need to make sure that your administration is on board with this. And so you would need to talk to your president and figure out a way to approach your administration, whether it's through a faculty member, through a club, through an organization, through a petition. Other campuses have done it in different ways. Identify if you have space on your campus that can be used for this purpose. Princeton is a campus that owns it, whether on campus or on the periphery of your campus. So I would talk to your facilities there to see what houses are available. You would only be hosting a family for several months. This is not permanent. This is on a temporary basis. And then you would connect with a refugee resettlement agency partner to let them know that
you have housing available that can house a refugee family for X number of months, from this month to that month. They look their cases that are arriving, and they would say, wait, we've got a six-member family coming from this country. Can they stay on your campus for the time of the availability of your housing? And so then at that point, you would mobilize your campus resources, your volunteers, you would collect coverage, you would collect donations, you would collect food and groceries, and then you would perform the tasks that have been assigned to you by the government agency to get folks their social security number, numbers to get them their immunizations, to get them their state IDs, etc. So really, it's a collaborative work between Princeton and your local refugee resettlement agency. You are not a resettlement agent. You are taking on the task to help with the resettlement agency in their work. And so you are constantly collaborating with them, working with them on how to best achieve that. I want to also let you know that if this becomes a Princeton program, then it is covered by the college insurance. Programs are covered by college insurance. Every campus of refuge and every family that we have hosted on our campus has been covered by our general liability insurance. And that's one thing to remember when you speak to your administrators. The other thing to keep in mind is that your campus has all of the resources that you need to do this very easily and very inexpensively. You probably have a storage or a warehouse somewhere on your campus with lots of furniture collecting dust that somebody needs to use. You probably have a confiscated rooms item or a lost and found room. Has a lot of the things that you might need. You have cafeterias, you have career centers, you have libraries, you have gyms. You are a city unto yourself. And this would be done very easily if a few of you take leadership role, assign tasks, assign volunteer tasks for folks to set up the huts, to collect the donations, to raise the funds. And so what I'm gonna do when I come to see you on Friday is walk you through all of those steps that you can take as a campus to become a campus refuge. For us, it was incredibly easy. It meant that one or two of us occupied leadership roles. And then we have, hello? Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, and then those two or three would assign volunteer tasks to a group of trained volunteers. Those volunteers would be trained by the Refugee Resettlement Agency in how to interact with their clients. The Refugee Resettlement Agency calls refugees who come into the U.S. through them their clients, right? And so you would assign those tasks, and everyone would, you can spread out those tasks so that this can be performed very quickly and very easily. I will tell you that in hosting our most recent family, the 11-member family that's with us from January until May, it only cost us $300 to furnish their house from top to bottom, because we are able to get everything else from our communities, whether it's our campus community, our friends' communities, our neighborhoods, and we ask for things through social media. The only thing that the college gave us was the house, free rent and free utilities. So if you're able to get that, and if you're able to convince your administration that this is an educational experience, I can talk to you about how the educational component comes in when I see you, but it's very valuable for our students who learn what it's like to sell refugees in Greensboro, what Medicaid looks like in Greensboro, how the DMV works in Greensboro. So if you can convince your administration that this is risk-free because it's covered by insurance, that it's incredibly educational, that it is necessary in a xenophobic, Islamophobic, refugee-phobic environment for your institution to be making a clear statement about radical hospitality, which is germane to all faith traditions, welcoming the stranger, that your campus can be a beacon in New Jersey. There's no other campus in New Jersey that's in every campus a refuge. You should be the first. So if you can convince your administration to give you a house, everything else after that is very, very easy. So I'm going to stop there, but I'm happy to answer questions about any of the things that I said. I will say that, just to give you a sense of our experience, we've hosted a single man, two Syrian families, currently hosting an 11-member family, and we begin hosting a 5-member family on Wednesday. In hosting families, we value their privacy and confidentiality. We never reveal where they're from, where they're staying on our campus, who they are, until they move off our campus.
Thank you, Dia. Thank you so much. I think we're going to collect questions at the end, and then if there are specific ones to you, we'll send them to you.
Sounds good. I'm going to be here waiting.
Look forward to meeting you in person.
Yes, great. I'll see you on Friday.
Yes.
Leave or do you want me to stay for now?
You can listen in. We're just going to continue. So,
if you have any questions for me later, I'll be here to take them,
great.
Okay?
Perfect.
Okay, go for it.
So as Dion mentioned, she's coming actually on Friday. So if you're interested in meeting with her, Chiara is spearheading that as well. It's nice to hear someone who's gone through the process lay out the steps, what it looks like, how you can envision being that beacon of hospitality here in New Jersey. I just also wanted to share, for those of you who are not familiar, the Nassau Presbyterian Church does this as a church community. So they partner with Church World Service, which is the local refugee, one of the local refugee agencies in New Jersey. And they actually resettled, every 5 years, they resettle a different refugee family. And just last fall, they resettled a Syrian family who's here in Princeton area as well. Also in Elizabeth, New Jersey, there's community groups that work with local resettlement agencies to also provide, as Dia mentioned, this additional support in the form of housing and then also community. One of the most beautiful things, I think, having seen the church interacting with this Syrian family who came, is how much learning happens, how many hearts open when you have that community-built support network. So we're happy to talk more about resettlement in the discussion, but we'd like to transition into sharing the voice of our Syrian student that we sponsor and are walking with on her journey through university. We spent yesterday morning in a Q&A meet and greet session with Noor, who is the student we sponsor in collaboration with Wesleyan University, as well as Yassine, who you'll also see. Yassine is also a Syrian refugee living in Zaatar refugee camp, and he's on a scholarship that is sponsored by John Hopkins, Carroll University, and Hamilton College. I'm going to give a brief introduction to who they are and kind of explain a bit of the Q&A context. It's just a quick clip, a 5-minute clip, to give you a sense of both their personalities, a little bit about what their daily life is like, why university is important to them, and who they are and how they connect with us. Again, Nawar is living in Zaatar refugee camp. She's originally from Deraa, which is in southern Syria. She fled to Jordan with her family in 2012, shortly after the crisis began in 2011. She had dreamed of attending university in Syria, but her financial situation with her family, where she's the oldest daughter, led her to have to work and delay her education. And when she had finally enrolled in 2010, the crisis imminently began, leading her to flee, both with her family for her safety, but also leaving behind her dream of continuing education and improving for herself and her community. In the refugee camp, she's not only a student, she's also an active youth leader. She works with a girls' empowerment program that's run through the UNHCR, the UN Refugee Agency, that focuses on empowering adolescent girls with leadership, with extracurricular support, educational awareness and encouragement, and prevention of gender-based violence in early marriage. And she's been a leading advocate for girls in the camp. Yassine, who we'll also meet, is also an active member of the refugee camp community with big dreams of making an impact, not only for his own family, but for all those within his current community and his home community in Syria. Okay, thank you. His passion is working with people with disabilities, specifically children and youth with disabilities. Inside the camp, after his studies in the university, he volunteers with an agency that provides services as well as recreational, inclusive activities. So with these communities, he teaches theater, gives creative writing workshop, and also offers different lectures to the other youth in the camp. So he teaches sign language, and he's currently learning Braille as well. With the Q&A, the goal we would like to show you is, again, a little bit about who these young students are, why their education is important to them, and then also just show the flavor of the dynamic between us, students chatting with students, with the aim of illustrating, as much as we maybe know it in our heads, illustrating close to our hearts that really all that separates us is distance. And these friendships and these bonds and these people are just like the bonds we have here in our own communities. And that's a big reason why we're motivated to continue supporting them, both as students supporting education, but also in regards to refugee resettlement. So with that, I'm gonna put on the clip. It is subtitled. So if you take a look, you'll see the subtitles coming up, and we'll jump right in.
Okay. Can you begin?
So, what is your day-to-day routine?
نظام الحياة وقت الجامعة تغير يعني صار برنامج مختلف تغير إحنا كنا نشتغل بس لما صار في جامعة صار في شغل وجامعة دوام بالجامعة فصار أيام الجامعة الفصل الماضي كان يومين بالأسبوع الفصل هذا صار ثلاث أيام بالأسبوع أنا بالنسبة إلي كل أيام الأسبوع عندي صار مساء من الأربعاء للسبعة وجمعة وسبت كان يتبرمت فوقت المساء بعد الشغل بعد الساعة 7 بيكون وقت مقسم بين البيت والدراسة والنوم.
طول النوم.
So we were wondering why higher education is important to you and your community. You know, it must be difficult because you have to give up work and so what motivates you?
أكيد في دافع شخصي يعني هو إنه هو بناء الذات يعني الإنسان بيبني نفسه لحتى يطلع يعني ما عاجبه مكانه إنه يكون بالمستوى هاي حاب يرفع نفسه بالعلم طبعاً بالفقه أكيد بس في السبب الأقوى والأهم يعني اللي بعد الإشي اللي شفناه بسوريا هلا كثير يعني خلينا نحكي خسرنا عقول خلال هاي الأزمة اللي مرت نحن بحاجة لبناء ومو معقولة أنا بدي أروح أجيب أشخاص من خارج الدولة ممكن ما حدا يجي أصلاً لأنه حرب وشيء فإحنا اللي بدنا نبني فإذا بدي أبني لازم أكون أبني على أساس سليم أطلع فيه فأكثر بأساس سليم لتطلع فيه هو الدراسة والعلم هلا بغض النظر أنا عم بدرس الشيء اللي بحبه أو لا هلا صار مفروض علي إنه خلينا نحكي أنا لازم أبني
So what's been your favorite moment so far at university?
كان في خوف انه انا اطلع قدام 100 طالب وقدم خطاب بس لمجرد ما شفت ياسين راح الخوف ما بقى خوف ابدا كنا دقيقة واحدة بس كان خوف بعدين يعني صرت أقوى من الأول
طبعاً الحمد لله أنا عندي ميزة إنه كل دكاترتي حافظين اسمي فاليوم في دكاترة رياضيات أنا جبت عندها فل 100% فكل شوي ياسين 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 فخلصنا المحاضرة فالطلاب كلهم بيجوا لعندي بيسألوني إنه ليش الدكتور عم تذكر اسمك كثير؟ حكيت لهم لأنه أنا فل فكنت كثير سعيد بصراحة وحكوا لي إنه بدك تساعدنا بالمادة إنه فيها رياضيات حكيت لهم ما عندي إرشاد
طبعاً شكركم على المقابلة وحلو أنكم مهتمين بمتابعتنا عن جد شكراً كثير جوية
لا أنا كمان أنا حابة أشكركم خلينا نحكي بكفي كان دعمكم لنا هو كافي بس انتم كانت مبادره حلوه منكم اضافيه انه عم تحكوا معنا وتفكروا معنا طبعا هذا بيرفع معنوياتنا بشكل اكبر كثير وبزيد اكيد اصرارنا انه نكون ان شاء الله من المتفوقين انه نحسسكم بقيمه الشيء اللي عم تساعدونا فيه وان شاء الله نكون قادرين على التغيير بالشيء اللي وعدنا فيه على المستوى العالي اكيد هذا بحقق اهدافنا واهدافكم اكيد وشكرا كثير جولي بشكل خاص يعني عن جد جولي غالي علينا بشكل كبير واكيد انتم غلاتكم وغلاتها وبرحب فيكم وسعدني اني تعرفت عليكم واكيد في شباب ثانيين ما كان في فرصه يتواصلوا معنا تشكرهم بالنيابه عنا واحنا سعيدين بانه عم نتواصل معكم وما شاء الله عليكم.
So we do want to leave time for discussion and conversation. I just close with three ideas. I think we really think about how to be involved locally and globally with refugees as being about service, it's direct service, it's in running in the refugee awareness race, which is coming up on April 1st. It's about fundraising, supporting scholarships, supporting organizations locally, resettlement agencies. And then it's about adding your voice to the conversation in your community for maybe people who aren't as passionate about the issue or as knowledgeable about the issue, also to your representatives. And with that, we would love to have maybe a discussion. We're happy to do questions and answers. If there are people who want to share a bit of their story, if you've worked in this area or have ideas you want to put out there for the group, we would also welcome that. So thank you. We're always happy to keep talking too, but.
I think one of the things that I'm just struck by in watching this video is just seeing how, you know, it's one thing for these people's lives to be a news story. You know, we see airport protests, we see, the what's happening in Europe on the news. But to remember that actually these are individuals with their own stories, with their own dreams, with their own childhoods, is really powerful. And to establish a human connection with somebody who has been through hell, and yet can laugh and smile and hope is really powerful. And inspiring. So I hope that, this is kind of my own personal reflection on this, I hope maybe that you guys got a sense of that as well. It's very easy to feel this kind of sense of that it's an impersonal crisis, but these are real people with real stories.
Do you have a sense of what the unmet need is in terms of refugees who are robbed of their college education, number of refugees in camps and elsewhere who want to go to university but can't? I mean, as powerful as that story is, it must be just hundreds, thousands, or more like them.
Thank you. That's a really wonderful question. And I think I won't go into statistics now because I hesitate without it in front of me, but there's a huge unmet need for youth, and it increases every year. As far as both the students who, taking the case of Syria, although of course this issue isn't exclusive to Syrian refugees, in the case of Syria before the war, 30% of their youth population was involved in higher education. So then when you imagine the numbers that have fled, how many people who have left behind, not finished, almost started, it's a huge number. Every year as well, we have children, of course. In the camp, for example, in Zaatari refugee camp, refugee children are able to go to school. So then, you know, they graduate maybe 12th grade, overcoming all the obstacles that come with being a refugee student in a new school system in a host country. But what do you do after 12th grade? And the crisis, of course, is going into its sixth year, and that increases year by year. So it's a huge unmet need. I'll add that there's a lot of really positive response to that need. I think the scholarship and the work we've done as students is one piece of that. There are also, for example, Students Organize for Syria is a group that, a student group as well, that has worked to provide scholarships for students who would be able to study at a university like Princeton, for example, or to come to the States. Columbia University actually is offering a scholarship, a couple scholarships for this. Right, Barnard and Columbia for this coming year, of course, pending whatever the Syrian ban and these things are, but for those students to come and actually study in New York as well. Here at Princeton, I'll give a shout out to a professor of history who's done great work around online education. So he actually teaches a global history course to Princeton freshmen, Professor Adelman, and he offered it to refugees, students. So it was offered with some extra support, both in the form of tutors and access to a computer lab for students, refugee students in Jordan and also refugee students in Kenya. So there are people filling this space, but it's a huge unmet need. And I think it's something we can all relate to as people who are passionate about higher education and its importance. Thank you.
I guess like speaking to Chiara particularly, but what have been some of the like optimistic parts of and the challenges of like trying to make Princeton a campus to keep refugees temporarily that you've encountered thus far?
I think the most optimistic part has actually happened this semester, ironically, with the election of Donald Trump. We've seen a lot of students coming together and wanting to focus on refugees. I mean, now we have a new student group that's starting called the Princeton Refugee Initiative, and they're working with Interfaith RISE, which is the local refugee resettlement organization. So I feel like this is, I mean, when we started the Clay Project, we were the only group of undergraduates that were focusing on refugees specifically. And so now that we see all these different groups that are focusing on different aspects of the refugee crisis, obviously, I mean, so Interfaith RISE works in local refugee resettlement. So that's a very local thing. We do fundraising for a higher education scholarship that is in Jordan. So, I mean, that's a very different kind of work that we're doing. And so I think that's really the best part is that we're now finding avenues in which students can volunteer and follow what they want to do specifically with the refugee crisis. Obviously, the biggest challenge is finding creative ways in which to get people to donate their money. It's always the biggest challenge. You can post a lot on our CrowdRise page, you can share it on Facebook, but after you've posted about 10 times on your Facebook page, like, please donate, people stop donating. And so it's always finding ways in which people can feel engaged and really want to give their money in different events. So this is why we try to do things like mug making, where people have fun while they're making their mugs. We try to have, we're going to bring a Syrian band to campus, and all the donations are going to go towards the Amal scholarship. So it's always trying to keep on your toes and trying to find different ways in which people want to come and give their money. That's definitely the biggest challenge.
Hi, so first, thank you for the presentation. I've spent a lot of my junior and senior independent work focusing on refugee crisis and internal and global internal displacement. And something that I've kind of struggled with is how we can think about the plight of refugees and IDPs as not separate issues, but something that's kind of part of a larger umbrella of displacement and global displacement in general. And I'm just wondering what you guys think of that and how we can sort of bring that to our campus and our community.
So I have an idea on it, but perhaps I'll speak from a personal capacity. When I hear your question, I think of root causes. I'm not sure if this is what you're getting at, but I think of root causes of why people are forced to become internally displaced or forced to become refugees. And in some ways, I think we have a sliding scale of what one does, perhaps as being a student. Community service is something people get involved in very fast. It's very real, you're right there, there's a refugee who needs ESL tutoring, you're in. Fundraising is a little harder. You know, you're giving up part of your paycheck, this is something you feel, you have other needs, you donate to other causes, it's a little bit harder. But the hardest thing is thinking about the politics of it, and really why is this the largest crisis, largest displacement crisis since World War II? How did we get here? How do we stop it? What do we tell our politicians to do? It's so complicated, they tell us. You can't do anything, they tell us. So I think that's something I've struggled with. Part of what we try to do is always incorporate awareness into our fundraising. And we also try to remind ourselves of the importance of advocacy. So we did, last semester, we as a group hosted a large letter writing campaign around refugee resettlement, as well as special immigrant visas. There was a telethon that was organized through the Princeton Advocates for Justice. That also was as far as raising political awareness. And I would just say, I think on a personal level, what you're doing as far as studying in your thesis and in your work and putting out ideas, that's a lot of what we do at the Woodrow Wilson School. Think about how can we approach this conflict from the realm of addressing the root causes. And I think we can't shy away from that conversation. You don't have to be an expert to think about it, and it's really important to think about too.
question?
Yeah.
Hi, have you guys identified any needs where, you know, old people like me can get involved? Because one of the things for my, I've only been volunteering in refugee resettlement support since December. And one of the pain points I'm having is that a lot of the local refugee resettlement groups are really not equipped to handle the uptick, you know, in public interest in this issue. And so, for example, if a place like Interfaith Rise says, okay, well, we need to do, you know, a supply drive for a family, you know, coming from the DRC in, you know, in a month, you know, our challenges, you know, we mobilize for such things, but they're not really able to keep up with, you know, kind of, there's a bottleneck from us to them. And so I'm just wondering, you know, do you have any needs, or have you identified ways for, again, that people outside of the larger community can help you? NPS, you guys are invited to Foodies for Refugees on the 18th, if you're interested in food and helping out.
Are you in the Princeton area?
I'm in Hopewell, so it's only 7 miles away.
That's awesome.
That counts. Thank you for coming. So I have a couple of thoughts on this. I mean, from, I mean, obviously, I think that with the current political climate, especially after the initial shock of the executive order on immigration and refugees wore off, you know, nobody's protesting at airports anymore. We've moved on, right? And as you know, we can't just continuously protest at airports for 4 years. So, like this, if we don't kind of transition that initial kind of impulse into a sustained letter writing and advocacy program, we're gonna be you know, lost in the noise of other issues and other things that people are upset about. But I think that this issue in particular really touches at the core of like what we want our country to be about and what we want our faith communities to be about. And so I think that continuing the advocacy side is not insignificant, and getting organized in that fashion takes some time, as we found, to be able to, you know, prepare well so that we can like quickly get a large amount of noise on an issue, and coordinating with others doing that is important. The other thing that I think is that, you know, just given that the fact that the scale of the crisis is so large, we have a limited impact that we can have on the crisis with those who have made it all the way through the giant funnel to America through the vetting process. But the vast majority of the problem remains overseas, and specifically in the Middle East right now. And so investing in, while it's more difficult to have a kind of personal connection with the issue that way, you have a much more strategic impact in investing in those who will rebuild Syria and Iraq in a way that those who made it to the United States and have the opportunity to establish a new life here may not return. And so I think that there's some advantages to, yeah, while it may be like a little bit like kind of removed from you, you have some addition, you can kind of see that there's like a strategic advantage.
And we're always trying to bring people on board to support more students. We raised 8,000, around a little over 8,000, and then partnered with Wesleyan to put Noir through 4 years of university. So 16,000 is only 16,000 for 4 year scholarships, pretty remarkable. I think for us, we're like, that's an impact we can have on one person we keep up with. If people are interested in organizing with their own groups or in their own spaces around that, we'd be happy to talk about it. And I think to the resettlement as well, again, there's an uptick in public interest, and I think it overwhelms NGOs that are already, you know, running around crazy to keep up with the needs they have. And I would say, and there's a couple different agencies in New Jersey, and I'd be happy to talk more detail, but asking them what they need, right? And maybe it's, I've had friends tell me, you know, I checked in with the IRC in Boston, and they said, I just can't take it now, but please come back in 3 months. Like Ben said, part of this is sustaining the interest. I'm here when you need me. I don't come for me, I come for you. So I'm here and I'm ready to offer when it is needed and what is needed. So, but that's great you're involved already, so thank you.
That's
for that.
Tough for a type A personality.
Yeah.
They should sit back. Well, I'm chill.
Another thing that, so I'm a member of a church here in Princeton, and something that we are going to be doing for the month of Lent is just practicing more radical community, actually. And so regardless of your faith tradition, I think this is something that really touches on like the locality of the issue. Like, if we're not loving our neighbors, if we're not like reaching out to those who are different from us, and inviting people in, to share a meal, to share a conversation, like, we're having, how can we even then welcome a refugee if we can't welcome those who in Hopewell or Princeton who may be different from us or maybe even look similar to us? So to start there and be cultivating cultivating community in general, I think is something that can intersect well with this issue as well. You know, if we talk about and make signs that we take to the airport saying, like, we stand for, you know, welcoming our neighbors, but don't actually do that in general with our actual neighbors, then we have a problem.
I like to work with immigrants. I've been teaching English for over 10 years to adult immigrants, and if you want to meet refugees and you want to meet immigrants and help them directly, teach English. You can teach, there are many places here in Princeton. I do it in Lawrence, but there's a church on the corner of Nassau and Gaber Street, I think it's Princeton Community Church. They start their English education program tonight. You can just walk in and they'll tell you how you can help. And it's a great way to make, you know, real connections with somebody from a very different situation, and it puts a face to this. And you really, I learn more from them than I can teach them. So it's a good value.
The challenge we're having in Hopewell, though, with offering these classes, just to put a different spin on it, is a lot of people who actually need that support won't sign up because they're afraid. So just, you know, it's not something we're gonna solve today, but just to kind of throw, you know, a challenge out there for us to think through. There are some legit afraid people out there who need help, but they just...
But see, Princeton and Lawrence don't have that problem because many of these people, they know about the program. It's one of the first things they learn about, so they trust us. And they're all done out of... The one I work for is Lawrence Road Presbyterian Church. Mm-hmm. But all the Presbyterians do a lot of good work with immigrants. And I'm an atheist. Mm-hmm. I do this because it's a good thing to do for my community, and I want my daughters to be involved and to see these... That we're all immigrants here. So you can either... be part of the solution or part of the problem. So I would rather be part of the solution.
That's a great note to end on.
Yeah. Yes.
I hope we can continue this conversation throughout the day, you know, in the public spaces. Thanks so much for coming, you guys. It's really encouraging to see you.